Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'd like to deal with one of the submissions of Senator Lakshmi-Dyal, which was not her first, but one that I think requires a little bit of attention. She referred to the language in section, well, it's clause, in the clause of the bill, which we seek to amend the act with, clause, to repeal section 3 and substitute the following section. That begins at page 4 of the bill, and then that takes us right across to page 10. And the point that she made with reference to that section that has been replaced by this bill is she would prefer to have consistency in the language that is used, because in some sections the words "in the interests of justice" are used, and in clause 313, in clause 316, there is used the words "the ends of justice so require." So she has expressed concern with the fact that there should be consistency and that the words "interests of justice" should be used throughout. And my answer to that is the words "interest of justice" and "ends of justice" can be used interchangeably. They don't mean anything different. But more to the point, we have the new criminal procedure rules. And I had introduced that when I was speaking on the earlier bill, the AJIPA bill, amendment bill. But I'd like to read into the record part 3, clause, or rule 3 of the criminal procedure rules 2023, which have been introduced in late 2023 to implement and work alongside all of the legislation dealing with the criminal justice system, and guides the discretion of all judges in the criminal jurisdiction. So part 3 of the Criminal Justice Rules 2023 is headed "the overriding objective." And part 3, rule 3.1, says the overriding objection is to deal with criminal matters justly. So let's bear in mind the interests of justice, the ends of justice, which are used in the clauses in this bill, where the ends of justice so require. Clause rule 3.1, the overriding objective is to deal with matters justly. Rule 3.2, it is the duty of the court and all parties and all participants at every stage of proceedings where the context so requires to further the overriding objection. And then rule 3.3, dealing, so this is a direction to all judges when they are dealing with matters which come before them. Dealing with a criminal matter justly includes A, dealing with the prosecution and the defense fairly. B, ensuring the protection of all of the rights of an accused person. C, considering the interests of the accused, witnesses, victims, and jurors, and keeping them informed of the progress of the matter as necessary. D, dealing with the matter efficiently and expeditiously. E, ensuring that appropriate information is available to the court, particularly when bail or sentence is under consideration. And F, dealing with the matter in ways that take into account Roman 1, the gravity of the offense, 2, the complexity of what is in issue, 3, the consequences for an accused and others who may be affected, 4, the needs of other matters, and 5, allotting to the matter an appropriate share of the court's resources while taking into account the need to allot resources to other matters. And then rule 3.4 says, the court must seek to give effect to the overriding objective when it A, exercises any discretion given to it by these rules, or B, interprets the meaning of any rule or practice direction. So it is my respectful submission to this House and to the members, and in answer to Senator Lakshmi-Dyal's concern at the inconsistency between the terms interests of justice and ends of justice, that whenever the judge comes to exercise a discretion as prescribed by the amendments that we are seeking to pass here, that judge is mandated by the criminal procedure rules to apply the overriding objective, and that overriding objective requires that judge to have regard to all of the matters that I've just set out. So that I do not think that the inconsistency in language, and I don't accept that, but it is the language that was used by Senator Lakshmiyal, the difference between ends of justice and interests of justice make a difference when the judge is sitting to adjudicate on the matter, because the rules prescribe the matters which the judge takes into consideration and gives that judge an overriding discretion to ensure that the trial is dealt with fairly in the final analysis, in the interest of justice, to meet the ends of justice. So that's my answer to that first point of Senator Lakshmiyal. Senator Lakshmiyal made a couple other points, which I will just touch on briefly. And one of the further points that was made is on the question of the definition of hybrid trial. This requires a courtroom to be sufficiently equipped to facilitate hybrid trials, and the government needs to ensure that resources are allocated for same. And in that general context, the concern was expressed about the witnesses and other persons having access to the facilities that the court is providing for purposes of dealing with hybrid trials. Well, one of the things that I answer in relation to that, in response to that, is that the judiciary has committed itself and expended a considerable amount of resources and money in equipping the virtual access centers around the country. There are currently 22 virtual access centers, five of which are in Tobago. That is under practice direction, May 17, 2021. Those virtual access centers have been equipped with customer service representatives, and this is in answer to one of the concerns that Senator Dylan Remy had raised as well, that litigants who do not have the required technology should be presented with clear guidance for the hybrid virtual access process and the need to ensure that persons have access that is necessary. I accept that concern, but in answer so to both Senator Lakshmiyal and Senator Dylan Remy, the virtual access centers, not only are there the 22 across Trinidad and Tobago and the five in Tobago, but those virtual access centers are equipped with customer service representatives to ensure that that self-represented litigants and witnesses who are using those centers have sufficient support and guidance when participating in virtual hybrid matters. So there is a considerable effort that has gone towards recognizing that people are differently able. When I remember many years ago when my daughters were very young and I was having difficulty getting access to my computer for something. My eight-year-old daughter at the time said, "Dad, give it to me," and she passed me back the computer in 2 minutes and said, "There, I've got it for you." The point is, people are differently abled, but the judiciary recognizes that they will give the support and dedicate the resources and the specialized service towards supporting persons who are differently able. And I don't mean that in a disabled sense, but some of us don't use the technology as well as other people do, and the judiciary recognizes that. So I see no hesitancy in recommending the hybrid and the virtual systems that are now part of our reality, which we are every day, and Senator Hasselbacus, who is our resident expert on these matters, has given us the assurance that it's not a panacea, it is not a silver bullet. There is constant daily commitment to improving the quality of the new world in which we live, in which so much is digital, so much is hybrid, so much is virtual, and the more we use it, it's like riding a bicycle. The first day you get onto a bicycle, you fall off, and you ride it a couple more times, and then you're riding without even holding onto the handlebars. You get better and better at it the more you use it, and that is what the virtual system is encouraging among the population of this country. We give it to you, we have people to help you, and the more you use it, the more familiar you become with it. So those are my couple answers to two of the principal concerns that were raised as between Senator Lutch-Medial and Senator Dylan Remy. I accept the concern that Senator Dylan Remy also makes that there needs to be sensitization and public education in terms of assisting the public in the rollout, and that is part of what I've already spoken to in terms of the commitment of the judiciary, which we are very, very much aware of. I had the unique experience, Mr. President, last year. I was encouraged to join the Chief Justice and the Court Executive Administrator on an IDB-funded trip to Spain to deal with digital courts. And I was present in Spain over a course of a week in training programs and visiting with Ecuador and four other countries out of South and Central America and Spain. And when we came out of that consultation, everybody in that consultation was overawed by the fact that the Trinidad and Tobago judiciary is ahead of many countries in the Western Hemisphere in its digital capacity and its technology that it has driven in making courts that much more accessible through the digital revolution that Chief Justice Ivor Archie has introduced to Trinidad and Tobago. And I commend him for that, and I encourage him to keep up the good work. Senator Timmal expressed some concerns. He was concerned about the removal of the registrar, and I say to Senator Timmal, under the legislation that has been brought into effect, Section 768 of the Supreme Court of Judicature Act, there is only one registrar of the Supreme Court, and all of the others are deputy registrars and assistant registrars who function substantively when they're in charge of their particular unit with all the powers of a registrar. It's a process of streamlining. There is also the other concerns that Senator Timmal has urged us, whether they using the term in virtual mode rather than virtually. Well, that's with respect, I accept. That may be for the drafter to consider. I don't claim to be a draftsperson. And as I said in the earlier debate on the earlier legislation, and in this regard, I would christen Senator Timmal as one of our stakeholders with whom we consult. As the suggestions come and we have to come back here to improve it, we will improve it. We will take that into consideration with the Law Reform Commission. As it stands now, I think that the bill that we have before the House is good enough to be passed in the language that we presented with, and I ask members to support. And with those few words, Mr. President, I beg to move. Thank you.